so that this year alone, an unprecedented 37 sequels will be released. The reason? Money.
The average sequel makes 8 times the
Holy
average
moly.
Original release.
That's $160 million over the $20 million original. Grown Ups, the Adam Sandler movie, which was rated an abysmal 30 points on Metacritic, received $270 million
Holy
worldwide.
Moly.
Its sequel, which somehow dropped 11 points, still managed $247 million worldwide. It was a box office.
That's amazing.
Hit. Audiences literally had no reason to give Grown Ups 2 a chance.
Keep in mind that the audiences are different from the critics. Sometimes people want to see a movie, they don't care what the critics say, they just want to see like a silly movie and have different stances than critics do.
And yet they did. Roger Ebert famously said, no movie executive was fired because he greenlit a sequel, but movie critics despair of sequels as betraying a lack of imagination and originality. If you have any doubt about how true that is, give Grown Ups 2 a whirl.
Oh no! Bonus!
Time travel in Game of Thrones explained, oh my gosh. Okay, so that's explaining a little bit about sequels. That's another angle on multiverse. Why are there movie franchises? Why movie franchises kill the original blockbuster? Why movie franchises versus Marvel movies on Hollywood box office? Anthony Mackie explains why Hollywood movies suck now. Oh boy. I'm curious what Anthony Mackie would have to say about this. Like, I don't know why he would be the person to say something about this, but I'm very curious.
Interestingly, in the past 16 years that I've been in it, because it used to be people going to the movies used to be an experience.
Yeah, I'm still streaming.
A family affair. It used to be an event. Whereas now, you know, if people will go see movies just because they said it's going to be number one, and everybody know the movie's bad. You know, you'll read a review on Rotten Tomatoes and be like, oh, they gave it, you know, 75% tomatoes. It's fresh. I should go see it. When they haven't even seen the movie. You know, so the evolution of the business has gone to, like, there are no movie stars anymore. Mm. Like, Anthony Mackie isn't a movie star. The Falcon is a movie star. And that's what's weird. It used to be with Tom Cruise and Will Smith and Stallone and Schwarzenegger. When you went to the movies, you went to go see the Stallone movie. You went to go see the Schwarzenegger movie. Now you go see X-Men. So the evolution of the superhero has meant the death of the movie star. And that's the fear now.
Superhero as a brand.
Making movies for 16-year-olds and China. And that's it. You think of some of your favorite movies growing up, those movies wouldn't get made today.
Goonies?
Wouldn't get made today.
Halloween?
Wouldn't get made today.
Thing?
Wouldn't get made today. And all of them, you watch Stranger Things on Netflix. Has anybody ever seen Stranger Things?
Yeah. Is that a comic
Stranger
convention?
Stranger Things is Goonies.
Is everything.
It's Goonies.
Yeah.
Three kids go on a mission, find underground, there's an alien, kill an alien, Goonies. Even when they found the little dark world where the alien was, they went down a slide like, Goonies. So, it's a different time now. The business, they make movies for specific audiences as opposed to just making good movies. And that's why people stop going to the movies, because most of the movies suck.
Ooh.
Stop remaking movies. Just, you know, stop. Of course,
Man, I feel I'm nervous. I'm nervous for Anthony Mackie here. I mean, he's Falcon, and he's obviously part of some very huge franchises and stuff. But like, yeah, I mean, he's saying some pretty real talk, and I feel like it's probably coming from a pretty informed perspective. And I'm kind of nervous, like, Anthony, rein it in a little bit. Like, I picture, let me put it this way. I feel like his agent, yeah, maybe he's talking to me. I'm picturing, like, his agent might be like, Anthony, just, like, end it right now. Don't talk any further. We don't want to make our... We still got a paycheck coming in next week. You can still make it up to them. Oh boy. Yeah, this makes me nervous. Wow.
Like Scarface, Godfather, Platoon, Smokey and the Bandit. Great movie.
Yeah.
Burt Reynolds, Harry Chess, can't beat it. Steel Magnolias. Don't remake that with a bunch of 21-year-old girls. They can't do that. You know, they don't have the experience. Those are women. Great movie, though. Coming to America, best movie ever made.
Yeah.
Well, anything Eddie Murphy has done before The Golden Child. Anything before The Golden Child, protect it, put it in a vault, never remake it. I take my kids to the movies to see Avengers. It's $150. I'm like, I don't even want to see myself that much.
Oh, shit. Oh, no. Uh-oh. Oh, my gosh. You got to be careful, Anthony. Anthony. Dude. Dude, this has 3.6 million views. You gotta be careful what you're saying, man.
You know, whereas I have a great sound system in my house with a great TV. I have my own popcorn maker. I got my own cabinet with my in it, you know what I'm saying? So I can sit here for $8 and watch this movie just like I'm in a movie theater, pause it, freshen my and come right back to it. So why go to the movies? So it's the cycle, the evolution of not only filmmaking, but the education of the film going populace that has evolved.
Yeah, I also think at least in America, like people kind of like have like had so many have like the opportunity to be exposed to so many movies for such a long time that like people can feel a little more, they can take Hollywood films for granted because they've been so catered to for so long. But a lot of these like kind of big movies are like have an international box office and stuff. And they can kind of, I don't know, that international box office is hungry for Hollywood movies because like they're like, we don't get enough of these movies. We need to see more of them. Because we never see this. It's a real occasion, special occasion to see something like made from this system and stuff. So, yeah. Okay, let's see what else we got here. Okay, let's...
Okay, I've been doing a lot of digging here, okay? I've been doing a lot of research. I've been reading these books about Hollywood and producing and global economies and the emerging China market and the emerging Russia market, okay? There's this one book called Sleepless in Hollywood, The New Abnormal. That's just really fascinating.
Interesting. Like, oh, this is 2016. Really keep in mind this is video came out 2016. And interesting books here. Where are these books? There's no citation on these books here. Interesting. All right. Sleepless in Hollywood. Let's take a look at this. Book, Scheinman and Schuster. Linda Obst. The industry where everything had once been familiar to her was suddenly disturbingly strange. Combining her own industry experience and interviews with the brightest minds in the business, Ops explains what has stalled the vast movie-making machine. The calamitous DVD collapse helped usher in what she calls the new abnormal, because Hollywood was never normal to begin with, and studios are now heavily dependent on foreign markets for profit, a situation which directly impacts the kind of entertainment we get to see. Can comedy survive if they don't get our jokes in Seoul or allow them in China? Why are studios making fewer movies than ever? And why are they bigger, more expensive, and nearly always sequels or recycled ideas? Obst writes with great affection, regret, humor, and hope, and her behind-the-scenes vantage point allows her to explore what has changed in Hollywood like no one else has. This candid, insightful account explains what has happened to the movie business and explores whether it'll ever return to making the movies we love, the classics that make us laugh or cry, or that we just can't stop talking about. Okay, let's check it out.
Whole new emerging market thing that's going on. And like, after seeing this movie, like, this movie is really apparently not made for American audiences. Like, this movie is very much made for the international audience, okay? And if you didn't know, the international audience used to count for 20% of the business of Hollywood. By 2008, it had come to be 50%, and then in the short time, it has evolved to 70-30, and now is soon to be 80-20, okay? Because Americans, we are not seeing movies as much anymore.
So the New York Times reports that 2016 could be the worst year for movies based on tickets bought by U.S. adults since before the 1920s.
So this is 2016.
I don't know if that's because, you know, we have, like, downloading. I don't know. There's a lot of different ins and outs, okay? This is a very complex situation. I think a lot of it also comes down to the fact that people aren't going to see movies because they keep seeing remakes and reboots and sequels, and people are just tired of it. I think specifically the millennial audience is tired of it because we grew up with the best fucking shit around, okay? Like, I grew up with fucking Ghostbusters and, like, Beetlejuice and, like, RoboCop, like, all this crazy stuff that was, like, all these original properties. And so, you know, you don't have people in America buying movies anymore. They're not going to the theater.
Interesting. Okay, let's check this out. This is Motley Fool. This is from Motley Fool. Why should you care why a movie makes money?
In this video, we're going to take a look at how movies make money and why box office numbers are often misleading.
Okay.
There was a time, not all that many years ago, when the public didn't know how much money a movie earned at the box office on its
opening
weekend.
That's
that made it possible for a film.
I guess that's something that must have happened over time. Like, the game industry doesn't really report on earnings unless they disclose it. And now it's, like, normalized to report on film box offices now. But games don't really report on that. They sometimes report on sales units. But not always.
Film to start, so it's slowly, interesting. And if it had good word of mouth.
And there must have been certain ways that came to evolve over time or something. And yeah, maybe it does have something to do with, like, you know, maybe even what Anthony Mackie was saying, like, maybe hearing about how much money a movie is making is actually convincing people to watch it even more or something. So that's good marketing for a movie. Is to hear how much it's making. They're like, well, it made $1 billion, so I better go see this movie. Everyone's watching it already. So they're like, oh, well, then we better start reporting how much money these movies are making.
Become a hit over time.
This movie made $100 million in the first weekend. $100 million, that's a big number. I better go see this movie.
Now, box office totals are widely reported. It's important to remember that box office totals reflect how much film to start slowly, and if it had good word of mouth, become a hit over time.
Okay.
Now, box office word totals are widely reported. It's important to remember that box office totals reflect how much people have paid theaters for tickets for a movie. And if film becomes profitable after the movie company has recouped all the money it's spent, not only making the movie, but marketing it. So let's take a hypothetical superhero movie based on the character Marvelous Man. Due to the success of Aquaman, Marvelous Man, the movie, gets a green light and a budget of $100 million, a relatively small amount for a superhero film. And let's further assume that the movie...
$1 million? I should watch a movie that makes $1 billion.
...actually comes in exactly on budget, At this point, the studio is $100 million in the red. It then has to let the public know the movie is coming. It does this by advertising, promotional tie-ins, like a Marvelous Man Happy Meal toy, and media junkets with the film's stars. That all costs money too, and has to be recouped well before the movie can be considered profitable. Let's pretend that another $50 million was spent on marketing Marvelous Man. There's no hard and fast rule for marketing budgets, but half of the production budget isn't uncommon. Now that the movie has been made and promoted, it's time for opening weekend. Say Marvelous Man the movie sells $100 million in tickets on opening weekend. It's a big number, but it's very important to remember that the studio does not receive all of that money. The theaters get a cut too.
And theaters get a cut too.
Well, it varies. For a huge film like a new Star Wars or Avengers movie, Disney has leverage.
Whoa.
It can negotiate a bigger cut and demand that the theater show the film on multiple screens.
So that even like adds to like why they would want to have a bigger franchise, because it adds more leverage to the side of the bigger companies. Interesting. That's a big factor. If you have a smaller production and it's you don't have as much leverage with the theaters, you can't negotiate for the cut as much. Interesting.
It can also ask for a higher percentage of the gross ticket sales in succeeding weekends. In general, the studio's percentage gets lower the longer a film has been in theaters. That's done to entice theaters to keep films playing longer. So in the first week of a film that's not a sure thing, the company producing the film might get 60% of the box office. That means that on the shocking $100 million in tickets sold by Marvelous Man the movie at the domestic box office, the company that made the film gets paid $60 million, meaning it's still $90 million in the red. The foreign box office is even more complicated, but it's all based on theaters getting a cut and the movie producers getting a cut. The math varies, but in a very broad sense, movies haven't made any money until their box office roughly equals twice the money spent on production.
Dang,
of
that's
course,
expensive.
Of course, the movie isn't done once it leaves theaters. Money is paid for streaming rights, a number that can be challenging to actually apply to any one movie, since deals tend to be studio-based for multiple films.
Right, and then if you have a thing like Disney, then it's just on a streaming platform. You don't have to pay the intermediary. It's already your own property and stuff. It's the same production company as the platform holder there. Interesting.
There's also DVD sales, rentals, an eventual pay cable window, then maybe a free cable or broadcast deal. And don't forget about the licensing opportunities with merchandise. But in
merchandise
the bulk
can be huge.
Of a film's revenue comes from its theatrical run.
Merchandise can be absolutely
huge. Let's take a look at a real example to break down how fixating on just the gross box office figures warps the picture of a movie's profitability. The much maligned film Solo, A Star Wars Story, made $392 million globally at the box, but the studio only got a cut of that total. The film had a reported production budget of $275 million and a big marketing campaign behind it.
Whoa.
We don't know the exact number, but it's safe to assume promotion cost $100 million, even $150 million.
It's a big budget.
So it's entirely possible that Solo lost a decent chunk of money, even on the nearly $400 million it posted in ticket sales.
Dang.
Unfortunately, running the numbers on the movie industry involves a lot of guesswork, because the cuts on the ticket sales aren't always reported, and marketing spend often isn't made public. The bottom line, however, is that most movies make the bulk of their money from the revenue split with theaters, and there's no clear way for the public to know exactly how much money any given film makes or loses. So the next time you see a big box office number, you'll know there's a lot more to the story. Thanks for watching this video. Which movies do you think were the biggest box office flops? Sound off in the comments section below. If you like the video, be sure to give us a thumbs up and subscribe. It helps us reach more people, which lets us make...
That's funny. Look, they're disclosing the shares they own.
Awesome content.
Wow, they literally disclose their shares and call options. Interesting. That's fascinating. Okay.